Good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thank you so much for coming out on this drizzly, rainy evening. April showers bring May flowers. Tonight's the second of four in our community education series for this spring. Nothing to fear, anxiety and its management across the lifespan. My guess is that we've all felt a bit of anxiety now and then, maybe some of us more than others. Our sessions, this is our fourth semester, and our sessions have really been wonderful. We've had a great time putting them on. They've provided a forum for rich conversation, learning, and a greater understanding of many topics. And for those of you who are not familiar with Howard Center, our mission is to improve the well-being of children, adults, and communities. We're a community-based center. We provide help and treatment for mental health, addiction and recovery services, and supports to people with intellectual disabilities and autism. So tonight's format is a one-hour presentation followed by question and answer discussion. For your audience participation, we'll walk around with microphones just so that the video is high quality, and for those viewers post tonight, they'll be able to hear the full discussion. We'll work to end promptly at 7:30. The community ed, our community ed schedule is in your folders. Our next event is on 4:20 at Main Street Landing, and it's a film, Crazy Wise, followed by a panel. And then we'll be back here for mindfulness with Dr. Arnie Kozak in May. So I do want to thank our sponsors, first and foremost, Dealer.com for hosting us, VCAM for providing the wonderful services that they do. Bill is over behind the screen, and then Joey is in the center of the room. Thank you both. Hickok and Boardman Insurance and Main Street Landing. We'll have the video online at howardcenter.org probably within 2 to 3 weeks, and along with tonight's slide deck. It's also in your folders, but we will also post it. I think Joe made a few changes, so that will be there as well. And then, without further ado, I'd like to introduce my colleagues and tonight's presenters, Joe Lasek, Kristin Allosso, and Michelle Fane. Joe's our Associate Medical Director. Michelle is our Director of Children's Outpatient. And Kristin is a children's outpatient clinician for us at Howard Center. Their full bios are in the folders, all very impressive, and so I welcome you all.
All right, good evening. Thank you for coming. The name of our talk tonight is Nothing to Fear, Anxiety and Its Management Across the Lifespan. I'm going to start off by acknowledging or endorsing the fact that fear is not always a bad thing. It's probably kept us all alive and saved our lives at one point or another. And acute fear in situations that are unsafe, of course, is a good thing. It's a good thing for us to experience. It helps us get out of situations or fight our way out of situations that are dangerous to us. There's a book called The Gift of Fear I borrowed the title from. It's actually a self-help book on how to effectively use fear in your life, and it's an interesting read, and I recommend it. We're going to be talking today more about the other spectrum, or the more chronic spectrum of fear, also called anxiety. Anxiety is a more diffuse, unpleasant sense of apprehension. It tends to last over time. But also not always a bad thing. It was anxiety that about a week ago got me to finally sit down and work on this presentation in earnest and get these slides into to Denise after her very friendly reminders over the last few weeks. But when it becomes a more persistent, invasive part of our lives, it then goes into the realm of what we call an anxiety disorder. I want to acknowledge that there are some cultural considerations when it comes to anxiety. Not all cultures treat anxiety the same. I'm coming from a Western medical kind of approach to it, and that's what I'll talk about tonight. But other cultures look at this from a spiritual perspective and as a spiritual problem or a more somatic or physical issue and deal with it that way. And there's no one right way to deal with it. I'm just going to talk about the way I approach it. Here's a cartoon. It says, how come when Peter Parker tingles in the face of danger, it's called the Spidey sense, but when I do it, it's called generalized anxiety disorder? You can call it whatever you want. If it's working for you, you can call it your Spidey sense, but if not, maybe we'll consider a disorder and try to help you with it. What are the anxiety disorders? This is basically sums it up. In our current diagnostic system in mental health, we compartmentalize anxiety into several different categories in order to help focus our treatment on these issues. Simple phobias, generalized anxiety disorder, panic disorder, agoraphobia, social anxiety disorder. We'll touch on those tonight. Two other anxiety-related conditions we won't be talking much about tonight, obsessive-compulsive disorder and post-traumatic stress disorder. We won't touch on those tonight. There was a talk on post-traumatic stress disorder a year or two ago, I believe, in this series, and I direct you to our website to check that out. It was a very good presentation. And in the future, very likely we'll do a presentation on OCD. The thing about all these conditions is that they are persistent and cause significant impairment. And there's been some criticism of the mental health establishment about pathologizing kind of normal behavior. And I think there's some credit to that. The pharmaceutical industry has been criticized of maybe trying to generate disorders to make more business for themselves. And I think there's some fairness to that as well. In my own practice, I really try not to pathologize what I think is normal spectrum of behavior. But when it gets to the point where it is persistent, it is severe, it is causing impairment and functioning or significant suffering, that is when I'll try to direct treatment to those problems. Just to give you a sense of how much of a problem this is in our society, almost a third of people at some point will meet criteria for an anxiety disorder during the course of their lives. So a very high number there. And in the course of a year, that's almost 20%. So one in five people will meet criteria for an anxiety disorder. Women tend to experience this at higher rates than men. It leads to significant functional impairment, so impairment in job functioning, school functioning, role functioning. There's significant societal and healthcare costs. And despite all these significant impact anxiety can have, 40% of people who have anxiety don't get treatment for it. So I hope at least those of you who are seeing this tonight walk away with the idea that, one, there is treatment, and two, it's a good idea to get anxiety treated if it is a significant part of your life. Anxiety disorders aren't clean. Most people who have them don't have one anxiety symptom meet criteria for one quote-unquote disorder. Anxiety symptoms tend to bleed into each other. They occur at high rates with other mental health conditions, particularly substance use disorders. Many people with anxiety learn to self-medicate before they even realize what they perhaps have is an anxiety disorder. I've worked with many people who start using substances in early adolescence or mid-adolescence to try to medicate their anxiety. Alcohol, nicotine, marijuana, opioids can all be used to self-medicate anxiety. So there tends to be a much higher rate of substance use disorders in those who experience anxiety. There's also a higher prevalence of medical problems in general. Having anxiety tends to worsen treatment outcomes for medical conditions and tends to worsen overall functioning. It also tends to increase the severity and chronicity of healthcare problems and increased healthcare costs. So there are not only significant personal costs to dealing with anxiety, also significant societal costs. And probably the thing that we fear most in the mental health profession, it's our worst outcome is suicide. And anxiety is associated with a much higher rate of suicide, up to 2.5 times the risk of committing suicide. And if you have anxiety and a mood disorder, that rate is even higher. And suicide is a very prevalent cause of death in our society. I'm not going to talk a lot more about that because we have a lot of other things to cover. But I did talk about suicide in the depression talk I gave, I can't remember when that was now, 6 months ago, a year ago. That also is on a Howard Center website. I go into more detail about that, and I welcome you to look at that if you're wanting to know more about suicide and intervening when somebody is feeling suicidal. So you may have an anxiety disorder if you have several of these issues here. Do you feel nervous, anxious, on edge, or uncontrollably worried? Do you frequently feel panicked or frightened? Do you often avoid situations because of anxiety? And does it significantly affect your life? And if you or someone you know thought they might have an anxiety disorder, there's a free online screening tool you can fill out and then bring that to your doctor or bring that to a mental health professional and have a discussion about whether you may have an anxiety disorder and whether you want to get treatment for it. If you think you might have anxiety, an anxiety disorder, I would recommend that you access treatment either through your physician or a mental health professional. They'll do a thorough medical and psychiatric history and exam, asking about symptoms, asking about your history with these symptoms. They'll look at your substance use pattern, because substances can both exacerbate anxiety and be used to self-medicate. And they'll ask you about your social history, your developmental history, your experiences growing up, traumas you may have suffered, other stresses that might be going on that might be affecting anxiety, and family history. Anxiety disorders have a very strong genetic component, and if somebody in your family is suffering with an anxiety disorder, that helps us both identify it for you, but also if they receive treatment that was effective, will also help us guide treatment for you. What are some risk factors for anxiety disorders? Personal history of anxiety or mood problems, being a woman, adverse childhood experiences and adverse family experiences can all increase the risk of developing an anxiety disorder. Chronic medical illness, behavioral inhibition, introversion, loneliness, family history, and lower educational levels are also risk factors. During an evaluation, a professional will rule out whether your anxiety might be actually due to a medical condition. It's not often, but it is sometimes the case that underlying medical problems can either cause or exacerbate anxiety symptoms. Things like endocrinologic problems like hyperthyroidism, diabetes, cardiac problems, respiratory problems, and seizures can all either cause or exacerbate anxiety. And then substance use. And I've seen many people who don't realize that the 10 cups of coffee a day they're drinking may be worsening their anxiety and causing insomnia, but it does. Other prescribed medications can do that. And then people also underestimate the effects of withdrawing from sedatives or withdrawing from nicotine. So many people will smoke right up until they go to bed or drink until they go to bed and then wake up in the middle of the night with a panic attack, and that can be withdrawal from nicotine or alcohol. And cannabis is a very complex substance when it comes to anxiety. Many people experience relief from anxiety when they use it, but studies have shown the longer you use it, the more likely you are to develop anxiety from it. And this seems to be due to some accommodation to the effects of THC or direct effects of THC. THC, especially at higher concentrations, which you see more in marijuana these days, can cause anxiety, paranoia, panic symptoms. So it's hard to convince people sometimes that this may be a cause, because their initial use of it leads them to believe that it's helping, but it actually can become harmful over time. And we're talking about anxiety symptoms. I understand it from like a physiologic standpoint. I think of like what's going on when the fight or flight system is activated. And this can happen in milder forms all the way to the most severe form, which would be a full-fledged panic attack. Panic attack being a sudden, severe onset of the fight or flight response, usually lasts 15 to 20 minutes and then resolves. And people often describe it as feeling like they're going to die or they're having a heart attack. In fact, neither of those things are happening. It just feels like it's happening because of the sudden onset of the symptoms. So one thing that happens is when your body releases adrenaline, noradrenaline, your heart rate increases, your heartbeat strengthens. This can feel like a pounding sensation in the chest, which can be very disconcerting. Blood flows away from the skin, so extremities become cold and clammy, or numbness, tingling, chills can be experienced. Blood flows away from the head, again, flowing to the muscles, getting ready to fight or flee a situation. Dizziness, decreased concentration, derealization, which is a feeling like your surroundings aren't real, or depersonalization, feeling like you're outside your body or not in your body. The most extreme form people describe, I'm looking down at my body, I can have a disembodied experience, or hot flashes. Blood flowing to the large muscles, that can feel like muscle tension or tightness. Breathing gets deeper and faster, and that can feel like a tightness in the chest, a feeling of not being able to get a good breath, and that can be lead people to think that they're actually not getting enough air or being restricted. And in fact, the opposite is the case. You're never breathing more effectively than when you're having a panic attack. You're getting more oxygen you possibly can use, and you're blowing off more carbon dioxide. And that's what actually partially contributes to the feelings of dizziness and lightheadedness. Your eyes dilate to get a wider view of your surroundings so that you know nothing can sneak up on you, and you're getting ready for danger. That leads to blurry vision or double vision sometimes. And then blood flows away from GI tract. The most common symptom there is dry mouth. But it can also give you that pit and fear of your stomach feeling. As your blood flows away, your stomach muscles start to contract, and nausea, and then other GI symptoms can result. After a panic attack or an acute fear response, the body naturally will go into a relaxation state by activating the parasympathetic nervous system or your relaxation system. Epinephrine and norepinephrine take a bit to metabolize, and so it can be a little while, an hour, 2-3 hours before you feel like you're back to baseline. And the thing with acute fear response or panic attacks is that your body does this naturally on its own. But for more chronic types of worry and anxiety, the body doesn't do it on its own. And that's one of the things that therapists will work on with you if you're suffering with anxiety, is learning how to induce the relaxation response on your own. And there's several ways you can do that. Mindfulness exercises, breathing exercises, grounding exercises, and physical exercise all can do that. So going into the specific types of anxiety, one by one here, just a brief review. Simple phobias, this would be fear of snakes, fear of heights, fear of public speaking, things like that. And we consider it a phobia and diagnose it as such when it causes some impairment in your life. Many of us have fears or avoid certain situations, but if it becomes so severe, like I have some folks I work with who have fear of elevators, they can't go into certain situations because they need to get on an elevator to get where they need to go, and they can't do that. So we consider that a phobia, and we direct treatment. And the main treatment for that is exposure to the thing you're afraid of and doing graduated exposure to the thing you're afraid of. So you might, if it's fear of a snake, you might look at a picture of a snake and feel very anxious, but continue to do it until you don't feel anxious anymore. And then you expose yourself maybe to a rubber snake, and eventually you might actually hold a real live snake in your hands until that you extinguish that fear response. Generalized anxiety disorder is kind of a generalized unease and worrying, difficult to control, often worried about future calamities that might or might not happen. And it's accompanied by physical symptoms that are uncomfortable. Irritability, muscle tension, sleep problems. Panic disorder is the experience of having recurrent panic attacks that are unexpected and unpredictable. And then having anticipatory anxiety when you don't have one. So worrying about the next one that's gonna happen. Also worrying about the implications of what these panic attacks are. We know panic attacks are totally harmless. Nobody's ever died from a panic attack, as far as we know. It's the same response as when you go jogging around the block and you get your heart rate up and you're sweating and your breathing is heavier. It's the same physiological response, but it comes out of nowhere, so it's quite worrying to people. And people often worry that they're having a heart attack, for example, or they're worried that they're going to go crazy and they're never going to come back to a non-anxious state. And then they start to avoid situations because they start to attribute being in certain situations that the panic is being caused by that. They believe, if I go to the grocery store and I have a panic attack, now I can't go to the grocery store because that's causing my panic. And they start to withdraw more and more from the world. Panic doesn't only occur in the context of panic disorder, however. People can have panic attacks once or twice and never have any other implications. They can have panic in the context of other conditions as well. Certain medical conditions can cause panic. And again, substance intoxication or withdrawal can cause panic. Any anxiety disorder can eventually lead to what's called agoraphobia. Agoraphobia literally means fear of the marketplace or fear of open places. And what happens is, again, people might be socially anxious, and so they start avoiding more and more situations where people are, or they might have panic attacks in more and more places, and they avoid those places. And eventually, their world becomes their home, or even in most severe cases, I've seen people bound to their bed because they fear they get out of bed. Their anxiety, they're going to have a panic attack or their anxiety will go up, and so they become restrained to their bed. It's obviously the most severe type of anxiety when it comes to the impairment that it causes. Social anxiety is the marked fear or anxiety about social situations. And here the fear is usually being scrutinized by other people. And they're worried that people are going to evaluate them negatively, they're going to think bad things about them, or that they're going to, something that they're doing is going to offend somebody. There is a variant of social anxiety, which is severe fear of public speaking. And there are specific protocols to treat that problem, and also a couple of medications that are particularly good at treating that issue. So if we have anxiety, what are some things that we can do? Well, the good news is there's a lot of things that we can do as far as treatment is concerned. The best way to deal with anxiety is summarized in this quote: fear has two meanings. Forget everything and run, or face everything and rise. The choice is yours. So the ultimate treatment for anxiety is to learn about it, be informed, and then face it. When I'm working with somebody, I'm going to teach them about the physiology of anxiety, why they're having anxiety, what's going on in their bodies, what's going on in their minds, what's happening, the connection between thoughts and feelings, looking at aggravating factors for them and trying to alleviate those factors, direct people to self-help books. There are a few that are included in your packet tonight. Also, some websites that have information can be helpful. Bottom line is, to recover from anxiety, we must face our fears. That's the bedrock treatment for all anxiety. And it's a bedrock treatment for the best treatments we have when it comes to psychotherapy for anxiety. The gold standard treatment we have is cognitive behavioral therapy, which means changing our thoughts and behaviors in order to remedy anxiety. The cognitive part of that is restructuring and challenging our maladaptive thoughts. So a lot of times people who have anxiety think that they have a thought, I can't go out at all because I'll feel anxious. Or if I have a panic attack, I'm going to die. Those kind of thoughts generate anxiety and make it more likely to have future panic attacks and future anxiety. So helping people restructure those thoughts can decrease anxiety levels. The other piece of cognitive behavioral therapy, the behavioral part, is exposure. I mentioned that already in the context of simple phobias. But if you have social anxiety, what that might look like is, if you have severe social anxiety, maybe having dinner with a friend. It might provoke anxiety, but be tolerable. So you'll do that until you don't feel any anxiety. Then you might go out with a few friends. And then you might go to a dinner party where there's, you know, six other people. And then you go to a larger party, et cetera. You gradually expose yourself to more and more challenging situations until anxiety is extinguished. There are other psychotherapies, Freudian-type psychodynamic therapies, interpersonal therapy, and others. Less evidence that they help anxiety disorders, but for certain people, that they may also be helpful. Group therapy is about as effective as individual therapy. Group therapy can be very helpful, say for social anxiety, where being around other people causes anxiety, so being in a group setting can naturally be helpful for that in an exposure paradigm. There are virtual reality exposure therapies, mostly in post-traumatic stress disorder. I've seen these studies, but you could use this in other types of anxiety as well. And then there are internet-based therapies, and this might be a good option for people who are maybe so severely agoraphobic they're not going to leave their homes to see a therapist. What I do in my practice, I do a combination of therapy and medications, and as a psychiatrist, I prescribe medications is my specialty. When would I consider medication for anxiety? I think of medications as second line to psychotherapy. I think psychotherapy is the best treatment for anxiety. I would consider meds for anxiety when talk therapy alone is not working. You're not making progress. How long would I wait? I'd wait 12 sessions. Most studies show that within 12 sessions, if you're not seeing improvement, you're unlikely to see improvement unless something changes in your treatment. So you might consider medications, you might consider changing the therapy or adding on to the therapy, but that's about how long I'd wait. When symptoms are severe or worsening, even while in therapy, I might consider meds. When other conditions, complicating conditions are present, if suicidality is present, we may want to intervene sooner and lower anxiety levels. Anxiety, as I said, is an independent risk factor for suicide, so we may want to intervene sooner. And then some people just don't want to do therapy or are so uncomfortable talking about anxiety to start off with, they won't engage in it, and that might be another time when we would use medications. So this guy's going to his pharmacist and asking him, What do you got that's not worse than the disease? We got a few things. Probably the best medication treatment we have, according to both efficacy and side effect profile and risks, are the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, SSRIs. Been around for about 30 years now. Prozac being the first one that came out, subsequent agents, Paxil, Celexa, and Zoloft, all have about the same evidence base to support their use, both in depression, because these are often called antidepressants, but they're also been found to be effective in anxiety disorders. So this is usually going to be the bedrock of treatment if you're going to use a medication. There's some newer agents called SNRIs, serotonin norepinephrine reuptake inhibitors, Effexor, Cymbalta, Remeron, can also be helpful for people, about the same effectiveness as SSRIs. And an older class of medication called tricyclic antidepressants, nortriptyline, amitriptyline, and mipramine. These have been around for a long time. Maybe particularly attractive in, say, those who have a pain disorder, because these have been shown to be particularly good for those in chronic pain. So if somebody comes to me and they're having chronic pain and anxiety, I'll often consider these agents. And then last, and I would say least, because I don't like these medicines very much, are the benzodiazepines. And these are Klonopin, Valium, Ativan, Xanax. Unfortunately, these are often the first line for many doctors. They reach for this because it works so well. Or people have used a friend, and they go to their doctor and say, well, I've used it. It was so helpful. Please give it to me. I'm going to tell you why I don't think these are such great agents right now. The main advantage is they work fast. But the main disadvantage in a behavioral context is that they work fast. Meaning that the thing that tends to reinforce anxiety, the thing that tends to increase anxiety and reinforce anxiety is avoidance. If facing your fears decreases anxiety over time, doing what the anxiety tells you to do, which is avoid it, strengthens it over time. And taking a medication as soon as you have anxiety is the ultimate avoidance mechanism. So while I do use these medicines, I might use it in context of where somebody's severely anxious and maybe suicidal, and I want to bring that intensity down a little bit temporarily, I'll go for these medicines, but otherwise, I'm going to be very reluctant to use these medicines. If I do, clonazepam is probably the agent I would use the most because it has a long half-life. It's less likely to lead to withdrawal for that reason. In studies that have been done on long-term use of these meds, they tend to be effective over time. The longest studies we have are about 2 or 3 years. They tend to be effective if you keep taking them, and there's no evidence of loss of therapeutic benefit over that time. However, no professional body and no national body around the world recommends use of these medicines beyond 6 to 8 weeks. Why? There's a lot of acute side effects, sedation, fatigue, and increased risk for depression. They're seen as depressants. They depress your central nervous system. They cause cognitive problems. Anybody's had the pleasure of having a colonoscopy or other kind of procedure where you need conscious sedation, they use these medicines to help you not remember it so well. But if you take it chronically for anxiety, it's going to have the same effect on your brain. In the last 5 years, there have been at least 3 studies I'm aware of, pretty large-scale studies, that show that increases the risk of dementia, including Alzheimer's disease. So this is not an agent that you want to be on long-term. There are also problems with balance problems because it suppresses the part of the brain that regulates your balance. That can lead to falls and hip fractures. Probably the worst group of people that would want to take these medications are elders, because as we get older, our balance tends to worsen, our bones tend to get brittle, and unfortunately, as a percentage, most of these medicines are prescribed to people over 65, which is kind of surprising and very sad because of all the problems that can develop from them. And then the ultimate side effect is increased risk of death, increased mortality. And there are now at least 26 studies showing that these medicines cause increased mortality from all causes. And this includes increased risk of accidents, falls, overdose, both intentional and unintentional overdose. There's actually increased, they suppress your immune system. So it makes it harder to fight off infections. So it's increased risk of respiratory infections and increased risk of cancer. Of all things, because your immune system is your frontline defense against cancer cells. So not great drugs to take long-term, can be very effective short-term. And right here, that reminds me, I want to say, This has happened before where people, I've heard after these talks, say, I heard your talk on this, and I stopped my medication right away, because this is so risky and scary. Please don't do that. Withdrawing any medication abruptly is potentially life-threatening. Stopping benzodiazepines abruptly, these are one of the few classes of medications that cause a life-threatening withdrawal syndrome. So you can have uncontrollable seizures, your heart can start beating erratically, and you can die. So don't stop them abruptly if you're taking them. Please talk to your doctor about the risks that I'm bringing up, because I think you should have that discussion with your doctor. By the way, many doctors are not aware of these risks. They were not taught to me in medical school. They're something I learned about afterward doing my own reading. And many doctors are a bit sanguine about prescribing these medications. I don't think they should be. And so feel free to talk to your doctor about it, but don't just stop them on your own. Finally, there's the risk of misuse and addiction with benzodiazepines because they activate the same part of the brain that other drugs of abuse activate, like alcohol and opioids and marijuana. And so therefore, they can lead to tolerance over time, physical dependence. If you stop them abruptly, lead to a withdrawal syndrome. And then some people can go on to become addicted to them. And the risk factors for developing an addiction on benzodiazepines include any history of a previous substance use disorder. Up to 50% of those who misuse alcohol will also misuse benzodiazepines. A family history of a substance use disorder or mental health problems, including anxiety. So we tend to prescribe these for anxiety, and anxiety is an independent risk factor for developing a substance use disorder with these medications. There are also risks with the other medications I mentioned. I'm not going to go through these in details. They're in your slides. But there are some irritating side effects like headache, sexual dysfunction. There are some more serious risks like risk of gastrointestinal bleeding and liver problems. And some of the SSRIs and SNRIs, there can be actually cardiac conduction problems that can cause arrhythmias. The worst side effect with SSRIs is increased risk of suicidality, which is highest in those under 25 years of age. Though I've seen it in those who are older. So if you were to start taking these medications and begin to experience severe irritability or agitation or suicidality, contact your doctor immediately. If they're not available, get to an ER immediately. Get it assessed, get it treated, please. Tricyclic antidepressants, older class of medicines, tend to have more annoying side effects than SSRIs. That's why they're not used so much anymore. And they have the unfortunate side effect of causing cardiac conduction problems that can lead to arrhythmias, particularly in overdose. So these medicines can be deadly in overdose. And we manage that by being very careful about asking about suicidality and managing that and using low amounts or dispensing only a few pills at a time. So this guy is asking his doctor, can we up the dosage? I still have feelings. And that is not the goal of treatment when we're treating anxiety with medication. But what are the goals? Well, we want to suppress anxiety symptoms as much as we can. We need to wait for them to work so that the, all except the benzodiazepines, take some time to work. So you have to give that time, work with your doctor, adjust dosage as necessary. If you achieve remission with these medications, you don't want to stop right away. Some people, you know, feel so good. They're like, why do I need to take this anymore? And they stop it. But those people who do, especially if you do it abruptly, tend to have a very high rate of recurrence. So you want to take these meds usually for about 6 to 24 months. If I'm working with somebody, this is when I'm encouraging them to really engage in therapy, deal with the underlying issues, develop the skills you need to manage it, and then we'll slowly taper the medicine. And again, don't abruptly stop this. These medicines, all these medicines I talked about can have a withdrawal syndrome if you abruptly stop them. If you're doing a meds versus psychotherapy comparison, which one comes out on top? Generally, they're about equal in the head-to-head studies that have been done. And combination is not always better than either therapy alone. Psychotherapy is certainly more effective after you stop treatment. So if you stop a med and you stop psychotherapy, there are some studies that show that after psychotherapy, your improvements actually increase over time. And that makes sense because you're learning skills, you gain knowledge that help you manage it more effectively over time. And there's also a generalizability to this. A lot of things you're learning about in therapy just help your life more generally. So I think psychotherapy wins hands down in this competition. Exercise. I'm big on exercise for everything. You know, somebody once said, if you they took all the benefits of exercise and put into a pill, you'd pay $1 million for it, because it's been shown to help everything: cancer, heart disease, depression, anxiety. I mean, there's nothing we haven't looked at where it doesn't help. Makes you wonder why we don't do it more. But anxiety is one problem that has been linked to physical inactivity specifically. The proposed benefits of exercise in the context of anxiety include things like you feel better about yourself, you're mastering something. It's a distraction maneuver. If you're sitting there at home not doing much, you're going to pay more attention to your anxiety symptoms. But if you're going for a run, you're going to be focused on other things. And then there's the idea of interoceptive exposure. You're generating symptoms that are anxiety symptoms: rapid heartbeat, rapid breathing, sweating, and you're learning it's not dangerous. Actually, you get that nice little runner's high after, and you get the parasympathetic nervous system kicking in automatically, which feels really great once you do it for a little while. So all that can explain why exercise is helpful in anxiety. Now, research that's been done so far, smaller studies, the exercise lobby is not as rich as the pharmaceutical lobby, but there is evidence to show that it decreases global anxiety levels, and that at least a few studies, I've seen these where they'll have people with panic disorder do acute aerobic activity for about 30 minutes, and then inject them with a certain chemical that triggers panic attacks, and the people who exercise ahead of time have a much lower rate of developing a panic attack. And the way you can think about this is you're using up that adrenaline, that noradrenaline, and you're activating that relaxation system immediately after. And of course, it's going to be harder to develop a panic attack in that context. When we have done this, the few studies that have looked at this in treatment of anxiety disorders, we found that both aerobic and non-aerobic activity can help anxiety disorders. Yoga, great intervention. I recommend this to many of my patients. Can be helpful for anxiety. And there's some evidence to show that more intense exercise is even more effective. Whereas general cardiovascular health, there seems to be a plateau of about like 1 hour of intense activity. Beyond that, you're not really getting much additional cardiovascular benefit. But for anxiety disorders, that doesn't appear to be the case. The harder you work out, the better it seems to work for you. There's more limited evidence for other interventions like Tai Chi, Qigong, or meditation, but they're all good for you, and I recommend these all to my patients and practice it myself, and I find it helpful. And I'm going to finish off today talking about herbal treatments, popular often in treating anxiety, but there's limited evidence in specific anxiety disorders. Again, the herbal lobby, not as well-funded as the pharmaceutical lobby. That might be part of the explanation as why these studies aren't as well done or even exist at this point. I tend to be more on the cautious side, not wanting to use things that I don't know, don't have good evidence for. And so I don't really recommend these to my patients. But the evidence is strongest at this point for passion flower, kava, and cannabis. Don't know much about passion flower. Don't think it's very risky from what I've seen. Cannabis, I've already talked about the potential risk there. I don't recommend that for anxiety at all. And kava, I think we're one of the few countries in the world that are still allowed to sell this because it's been linked to liver failure. And so I wouldn't recommend kava for anxiety treatment. And that's my part. I'm going to turn it over now to Kristin. Are you going first? Kristin Allosso will take us from here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kristin Allosso at the Howard Center. Who knows anxious kids? Anyone? Okay, that's why we're here. So I'm going to talk in a minute about anxious behaviors, but before I start, here we go. Is anyone familiar with Dr. Bruce Perry and his work? Okay, so to understand anxiety in children, it's important to understand that their behavior is telling us that they need something. Before we get to what those behaviors are, this is a continuum of emotional states and how to respond to children based on which state they're operating from. And so this is Dr. Bruce Perry's work. He's a psychiatrist and a researcher in children's mental health, and he's done a lot of research on trauma and the impact on brain development in children. And so this arousal continuum explains from a From a neurological perspective, responses to behavior that are either effective or ineffective, based on the child's emotional state and which part of the brain is being activated at the time. So, for example, you have this in your packet, but for example, you know, so someone who's in a calm state, you know, they are able to think and problem solve and process with someone about what's going on, and they would benefit about talking with an adult and processing a situation. Whereas someone who's in way to the other end and like a reflexive state of terror in flight mode, they're operating from the lower part of the brain, the brainstem, and they're not able to verbally process or, you know, or talk, verbally express what's going on. So they're going to need time and space to calm down and get regulated, you know, they and to take a break in order to be able to then process their emotions. So there's no kind of problem solving that's going on in that moment. It's, you know, so being physical with a child or yelling or expecting them to come up with solutions or to work with you on solutions in that moment is not going to be effective, and in fact will probably escalate their behavior in that moment. So this continuum, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but this continuum, it's a good reminder for us as the adults and the caregivers to really be able to manage our own affect and model for them how to self-regulate. So this handy graph kind of reiterates as the arousal increases, so as they get more more anxious, more escalated, their cognitive ability, their thinking brain decreases, and their thinking brain essentially shuts off, and they're stuck in survival mode, you know, and whether that's, you know, freeze, flight, flee, and they can't be reasoned with. Like I said, I think of a good example of the Charlie Brown comics and the adults in the Charlie Brown, like the wah, 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 like that's what they're hearing when we're trying to problem solve with them in these moments, when they're kind of operating from up here. So they have to be down here, and we have to be down here as the person responding to them in order to be able to get them to process what's going on. So I'm going to move all this stuff. So the feeling system, so figuring out feelings, the children's feeling systems can be difficult. And I should add, when I say kids and children, I mean kids and teens for the purpose of this presentation. All ages from young kids on up to teens. So anyway, they're not often able to identify or communicate their intense feelings with words. And so they show us with their behavior. And it's our job as caregivers and teachers and adults to be detectives and figure out, you know, what need is not being met. And that's how they're trying to tell us that. And so, you know, to think about, you know, what are they trying to tell us? You know, hey, so we can take this approach of, you know, hey, what's going on? You know, be from a place of curiosity, you know, and it seems like this was a really hard, by your facial expression, this you're telling me this is a really hard situation for you. Or so an approach of curiosity as opposed to making assumptions or shaming them for their behavior. So just, I think the biggest takeaway for me is, what need is not being met in that moment, and how to figure out with the child, because they may not know. So they need us to help them figure out what they're needing in that moment. How can I help is a great question. They may not know, but, you know, it sparks a discussion. So anxious behaviors. So when children are regulated, right, they have good impulse control, they can monitor and control their own emotions and their behaviors and their feelings. They're flexible enough to alter their feelings and their behavior to meet whatever the situation is, to whatever the situation calls for. And then when they're dysregulated, when they're dysregulated, these are some things that we can see. And so, you know your kid or your student or your player on the team. So this is a guide. So you know how they are, and you know if it's going beyond like their normal limits. So irritability, I know it's hard with teens, right? They're always irritable, but is it, you know, more than normal? Difficulty with attention and focus, you know, are they extra extra fidgety, kind of moving around a lot? Are they avoiding friends or family gatherings? Or, you know, are they skipping classes, skipping practices, skipping school? You know, maybe are they using substances? Are they, you know, maybe getting into conflicts with coaches or friends or teachers maybe that they haven't in the past? Or is that kind of amping up a little bit? So are they becoming maybe more aggressive? Are they being more inflexible, more emotional? anger is often a front for anxiety. So, and a lot of times, this angry, aggressive behavior is actually, it's kind of like that iceberg, right? Like that angry iceberg, you know, it's, anxiety is anger is a big front for anxiety a lot of times. So it's important to kind of dig through those behaviors to see really what's up. So specifically in the classroom, and we're going to get, Michelle's going to talk about strategies, and then I'm going to get back to specific strategies for the classroom, but I don't know if there's any teachers in the room or school staff in the room, but for anxiety specifically in the classroom, intrusive worrying. So worrying about things that are really interfering with their learning and really interfering with their day, about, you know, whether it's grades or, you know, performance on in an oral report or on tests, hard to concentrate, frequent interruptions. So if they're up out of their seat a lot, they have to go to the bathroom a lot. Visits to the nurse are a huge indication that there's something going on. Like I said, performance anxiety, being critical of themselves. We see a lot of this, like being perfectionists and just being rigid and kind of inflexible with themselves and their expectations of their own performance. Avoidance of what's going on, avoidance of whatever is anxiety provoking. So classes, practices, all that kind of stuff, friends, skipping school altogether, falling asleep in class, being hard to wake up in the morning, sleeping a lot, feeling extra kind of lethargic and sleepy, having really low self-esteem, low self-efficacy, you know, like their ability to succeed is really low. And not there, and not participating in stuff, choosing not to participate in stuff. So long-term effects of anxiety, and I think Joe had talked about this a lot too, but, you know, so being in a chronic state of stress, right, it has a, you know, mental and physical impact on a lot of different aspects of your life. And so, you know, because relationships can be complicated, sometimes because they're being avoided altogether, or sometimes because of the behaviors that kids are exhibiting. So there's a weak social network, social supports kind of fall away, relationships are unstable, whether it's with friends or family members or coworkers, teammates, increased risk for substance use and abuse. Mental, like I said, your mental health and physical health is challenged with your weakened immune system, right? If you're always in a chronic state of stress, over time, it weakens your immune system. You're at risk for depression and substance abuse, like I said. And then because all of these things are complicated, you don't really have a lot of positive reinforcements in your life. So you're not getting that reinforcement from that sense of belonging from your peers or family, or because it's a lot of negative. You're getting a lot of negative attention because your behaviors are negative. So that was quick. Michelle's going to talk about strategies, and then I'm going to come back to talk about classroom.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here on this rainy Thursday night. So how do we help kids with anxiety? When children are chronically anxious, even the most well-meaning parents and caregivers can fall into a negative cycle. And not wanting a child to suffer or watch them struggle can actually exacerbate the anxiety cycle. It happens when parents, caregivers, anticipating a child's fears, discomfort, and anxiety try to protect the child from them. So the goal really isn't, as Joe talked about, to eliminate anxiety or avoid it, but really to help the child to manage it. it's hard to see kids struggle as parents, as caregivers, as teachers, as community members. It's hard to watch a kid struggle. But really the best way to help them overcome their anxiety and their fears isn't to remove the stressors. The best way is to help them learn to tolerate the anxiety and to function as well as they can, as best they can, to their best capacity, even when avoiding the anxiety and the fear triggers are uncomfortable. Avoidance makes them feel better in the short term, but in the long term, it reinforces that cycle, and it actually helps the anxiety take more of a root. So what we're talking about here is distress tolerance and how to build distress tolerance. And distress tolerance really helps a child create a capacity for managing the anxiety and not avoiding it. So push through the fears, push through the anxiety. So some skills to help to build that and to put into their toolbox would be helping them do intentional distraction. So when the anxiety peaks and is at, you know, their most flooded, helping them to distract by other activities, other behaviors, and other thoughts. Other things for the toolbox for the child would be learning and practicing self-soothing skills. So deep breathing, in through the nose, out through the mouth, to a count of 10. Progressive muscle relaxation, starting at the head and working all the way down to the toes. So those are some examples of how to help the kiddo build a toolbox. When your child is anxious, or when a child is anxious or fearful, helping to express positive but realistic expectations is the direction we want to help them move in, because you can't promise a child that their fears aren't going to happen or that their worries aren't going to come to pass. But you can express in them a confidence that they can work through it, that you will be there for them, that they're able to manage it. And as they face their fears, the anxiety will decrease over time, and much of the time it will fall away. Validate what they're experiencing, but validation doesn't equal agreement. So you want to listen empathically. You want to do some reflective listening. What I hear you say is that you're worried. And help them understand what the anxiety is and encourage them to face it. So a great example of this is a child who's afraid to go to the doctor. They're afraid they're going to get a shot. Helping to validate, I hear that you're worried, I hear that you don't like shots, versus minimizing it for them. Well, don't worry, if they're over quick, shots are quick, it's really nothing, and you'll be fine. Or amplifying it. I know exactly what you mean. I hated shots as a kid, I avoided it, I stayed home, I threw a fit. We're really looking to strike a balance of validation, but also confidence in the child that they can do it, that they have the skills to get through it. And try not to ask leading questions. So instead of, are you worried about the science fair, which really, at its core, kind of implies that they should be worried, it's more, how are you feeling about the science fair? Open-ended questions like that allow a child to sort of take that conversation anywhere, and you'd be surprised where some of those conversations will go, and they may not be worried about it at all. Try not to reinforce the child's fear. So back to what Kristin was saying around caregiver affect management and really being able to be in control of your emotions and in control of your reactions has a powerful impact on kids. Kids are perceptive human beings. They're sort of like detectives in their own way. And they pick up on parents' stresses, and they watch how parents and caregivers manage those stresses. So modeling healthy ways to manage your own stress and your own anxiety as a parent, as a caregiver, as a teacher, really is sort of an indirect way of teaching your child coping skills around anxiety management. When possible, reduce the anticipatory period to a minimum. So what we know is that when we're afraid of something, the hardest time is right before it happens or right before we have to do it. Back to the example of the child going to the doctor. So if possible, don't let the child know several days ahead of time, hey, you have a doctor's appointment coming up. Maybe a couple hours or the morning of, because then they don't need to suffer that worry, those days beforehand. think things through with the child. So sometimes it helps to talk things through, talk scenarios through, if their fear, their worry, their anxiety did come to pass. So a great example is if you have or you know a child who has separation anxiety, worries about being away from parents, and they're worried that maybe the parent won't come back to pick them up, the caregiver won't come back to pick them up. One of the things you can do is say, well, if I were late, for example, and you became worried that I wasn't coming back, who could you go to? And generate a list of known adults that are safe, that the child is comfortable with. What would you say to that adult? And help them rehearse what they could say to get the help they need. It gives them a sense of agency and control. So it's sort of the, if this happens, then what will you do? You're making the if, then what plan. So teaching and modeling effective responses to stress and communication of emotions is really an opportunity to help our kids build their own capacity. Teaching specific coping skills, like deep breathing, like I was talking about, in through the nose, out through the mouth, to a count of 10. Muscle relaxation, progressive muscle relaxation from the head to the toes. Grounding activities. So when we do grounding activities, we use our five senses. So sight, smell, touch, hearing, and taste. So when a child is particularly anxious, you could say, do you feel your feet on the floor? I want you to stomp your feet a few times. You feel the floor underneath you. I want you to look around and name five things that you see right now in this space. I want you to tell me five things that you hear. It really helps reinforce for the child that you are here, you are in the present, you are not there where the worry is, and you are safe. A couple other things. There's some great apps on phones now for relaxation, mindfulness. I would encourage folks to use those and kind of explore them a little bit. Drawing, reading, music, all really great tools as well. Allowing a child choices when possible is really helpful. Children, when they're experiencing anxiety and fears, it's as if it's happening to them, and they have no control over anything. So when possible, offer choices. It really helps them with a sense of agency and control. Minimize emphasis on competition, whether it's academic and grades, or socially, or through sports. We really want to be shifting the focus to celebrating the successes of when they're anxious and they employ their coping skills. Those are the pieces that we want to be focusing on. So, Joe had mentioned the importance of physical exercise and activity. That goes for everybody. Helping kids get out, get moving is another tool for their coping toolbox. Reducing unnecessary stress in the home environment is key. Even too many healthy scheduled activities can become stressful if it's too much. So, right, the overscheduled child is a great example. Monitor conversations for topics that are sensitive to the child. So recent losses of a person or something, housing instability, food instability, conflict between family members, both near and far, neighborhood conflicts, those kinds of things. Sometimes it feels helpful to give kids more information because it seems to help them with their worries, when in fact, if the content of that information is adult-related, it increases their worries and their anxiety. Because then they have all these adult worries and they have no way to impact any change. Providing sensory tools when needed, so yoga balls that they can sit on and rhythmically bounce on, worry stones that they can hold in their hands and rub between their fingers or between their hands. Fidget toys, again, that distraction technique. Weighted blankets for sensory input can be very helpful as well. And helping a child identify negative thoughts and then encouraging the positive self-talk. We want to shift to the positive and away from the negative. So, for example, a child says, like, I can't learn math. I'm just no good at it. I can't do it. Help them to reframe it instead to, I can learn math with support. teaching a child to recognize mood patterns and triggers. We often recommend journaling for this to really track moods and what happened right before or after that mood, so they can kind of gain some insight into what might be driving them, what might be driving their anxiety and their stress. Collaborating with health providers to develop a healthy sleep routine. We know the importance of sleep, getting enough of it, quality of it. That's additionally important with anxiety and stress. And then providing positive feedback when your child uses their coping skills. So we want to, again, celebrate the successes and really play on the positives. The more we do that, the more that coping skill will become an automatic go-to for the child, and they will use it regularly to manage anxiety. Kristin's going to talk about some classroom interventions, and then we'll take some questions.
So if you're if you work in a school, or if you're a parent of a child experiencing anxiety in school, these are a couple slides of some good ideas on how to make it kind of an emotionally safe place for a child. Kids spend like a third of their day in school, so if it's an anxiety-provoking place, that's like torture for them all day to be in there. So, you know, some strategies that have been effective, scheduling. I'm looking up there. I can look down here. Scheduling check-ins. So throughout the day, kind of gauging where they're at emotionally from one activity to the next. Have them identify a staff member at school they can check in with when they need to. Provide them a place and some time to maybe do like a self timeout, not as a consequence, but kind of as a preventative measure, if they're feeling like, maybe regularly scheduled, maybe three times a day. There's a set time where they have a check-in in addition to when they're actually needing it. Encourage them to develop, like Michelle was talking about, strategies, coping skills, all of those things that Michelle mentioned, the progressive muscle relaxation, imagery, relaxation, have all those fidget toys, that kind of stuff, so they have an opportunity to learn or to use the skills that they've learned. Adjust homework load and expectations. Be aware that there could be a lot of triggers in school that adults don't know about, and kids also can't identify. They don't know their own triggers. So just know that that could be happening. If there's a behavior that's happening and you're not sure why, it's likely that they're triggered by something. Encourage the positive self-talk. Let them have opportunities to learn skills and to use them. Acknowledge and validate their feelings, right? So something could seem completely out of nowhere and very trivial to us, but to them it's very real and it's very big. Like if I was afraid of mice and Michelle wasn't afraid of mice and a mouse ran across the floor and I, kind of lost it, it would be a huge mouse. It would be like the size of the room to me, and to Michelle it would just be like this little mouse running across. So with kids, we just don't know what their triggers are. I mean, a lot of times we do, but a lot of times we don't. And so that's important to think about. And then, like we've heard throughout this entire presentation, physical exercise and physical activity. Bruce Perry suggests, I don't know what the exact time frame is, but, every 15 minutes doing some kind of a sensory break in class, whether it's bouncing a ball back and forth or sitting on a yoga ball or whatever that is, taking a walk around the campus or something like that, really important. To kind of front load for when times later in the day might be anxiety provoking. This might be my last slide. It is. That's it. Thanks.
So we'll take questions. And Kelly, maybe you could help me. Could you? Did I see a hand?
Could you give some suggestions of how to access cognitive behavioral therapy in this Chittenden County area? Where does one go for it?
I could start with adults. There are a few locations that specifically offer that. I know Otter Creek Associates has an anxiety disorders clinic, and that's down on Lake Street in Burlington. They have several therapists there. UVM Behavioral Therapy Center, which is a training center at the Department of Psychology at UVM, offers it. And then it's certain therapists offer it around the area. Either they might advertise it online, or when you call, you can ask. That's the only other way I know of is to call and ask whether they offer that.
I would say, too, checking with your insurance, depending on what your insurance coverage is, they will have a list of providers who, you know, on their panel with different specialties. And so that's a great way to look into that as well. And then Psychology Today has an online option where you can research providers in the area and what their training is and what their specialties are.
Is there a fine balance between if someone's on, say, drug therapy and psychotherapy? Is there a balance between getting off that medication before starting, or?
Yes. Yeah. So it's all very individualized according to who you are, what medication you're on, the effectiveness of the therapy you're doing, how strong you feel in learning the skills in therapy that you've learned. And sometimes you don't know. And sometimes you might try coming off medication and it doesn't go so well, and you might go back and do the therapy a little longer. And it's all very individualized. So there's no clear-cut answer for any, in any general sense. It's a good question.
Well, I was just wondering, in the section you had with physical things that might trigger anxiety, like thyroid and things like that, you didn't mention strep infections. How common is that?
Are you referring to the OCD that is caused by strep, or some other anxiety?
I think OCD would be one of the things too, but also just anxiety caused by strep that maybe you didn't even know you had.
Pandas would be a strep infection that can lead to OCD symptoms in children, particularly. But I'm not aware of more general cause of strep infection causing anxiety in adults. That's news to me.
Hi, I'm curious about what strategies you might have for teens who might not necessarily be really into trying lots of different things. So they're a little bit resistant to exercise, or if they're sleeping, you know what I mean? That teen thing.
Teens are resistant to things?
Well, I mean, I think Michelle mentioned, chime in too. Michelle mentioned the apps. And there are really, really good ones out there, you know, screen time aside. I mean, I feel there are some great apps, like Calm is one of them.
Insight Timer is one I use and I recommend to my patients.
Could you say that again?
Insight Timer is a free app, Google Play, App Store, and it's also available. You can use it as a web browser.
And Calm is another one. And I think that's perhaps a hook too, right? So you hook them that way, and then perhaps they're open to start doing some of that stuff because it's a screen, and they might be open to it. But then, you know, if in fact it works a little bit for them, they might be open to doing other stuff. To start, I don't know. You have other ideas?
I mean, I think the other idea that I have is less about an intervention that, you know, that you're describing or that you're looking for, and more about pointing their attention to what's another time that you were resistant to trying something and it worked out well. And really kind of broadening it for them a little bit and pulling in other experiences, not specific to what's being recommended, but that they were resistant to, and it was a success, and then trying to generalize it.
And I think what Joe said earlier, too, about educating them about what anxiety actually does physiologically, I think, you know, some kids could really grab onto that because it's not our opinion necessarily, right? It's not something that we're like, hey, this is, try this. I mean, this is fact and it's based on research. And I think for a lot of teens that I know, that really goes a long way because it's removing, say, myself as a therapist or as a mom, it's removing that. It's like, hey, this is like this really good article that's based on a lot of research. Check this out.
Okay. I have two questions. From reviewing panic attacks, that in one case it seems like the person screams, but it comes on very suddenly, and she's doing yoga or something, and then she comes out with this loud scream, surprising people. And the other is that things seem to be all fine. You're walking around feeling great. You're very positive. And then all of a sudden, it's like a shade that just pulls down over your head or your face, and you could just be even in the shower, and you start crying, and everything goes negative, and it's like nanoseconds, things go from positive to negative. Are those considered panic attacks, or are those considered something else?
I don't know. I really have to know more about it. Know what the actual subjective experience is and what kind of symptoms were happening. I think you could treat it as if they were and use the same principles.
But that wouldn't be those, neither of those would be like normal or most panic attack results. So it could be something else.
It's so different for everyone.
Yeah. Well, I understand that. Yeah. But you know, in some cases, I mean, you're saying people can be frozen to the bed and can't move.
Yeah. Right.
But I didn't see anywhere in your notes that people actually went from a positive to a real negative mindset without the other things, without the sweating or the palpitations or...
No, usually a panic attack is defined by the presence of those fight or flight symptoms.
Okay.
And there's certainly other mental experiences that can happen, similar to what you're experiencing, that we wouldn't call a panic attack, but maybe associated with anxiety, trauma, like what you're describing often. I've heard people who have a history of trauma all of a sudden, without really knowing what the trigger was, develop a very rapid change in mood, or you dissociate out of their body in some way. And sometimes it's a trigger they're not immediately aware of consciously, but it could be a subconscious trigger.
This yeah. is these are two friends of mine, so I was checking to see if those could be panic attacks.
Could be, or it could be other some kind of anxiety or some kind of traumatic association is the other thought I have.
Okay. Well, I think in one case it could have been trauma.
Yeah. I mean, I think the shower example, I know of people who may have been traumatized in a bathroom or in a shower, for example, and then they may not be aware of it, but when they're in a shower, their anxiety may increase because of that unconscious association.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's interesting. Thank you so much.
Yeah, my pleasure. Would you mind using it just so, for the folks at home that are following
sure.
along?
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. So you touched base about the uses of cannabis and the effects of THC on anxiety. However, you never touched base on the use of CBD for anxiety.
Good question. Not a lot of research on CBD, a lot of promising early research. But what's that? Sorry. The question was effects of cannabis and THC potentially having negative impacts on anxiety or potentially positive. But CBD, cannabidiol, which is another cannabinoid found in marijuana and now is looking at, it's been looked at as an isolated compound in treatment of anxiety disorders, sleep problems. And there's some promising stuff out there, but it's still not at the level where I would recommend that yet. Though I certainly know people who have used it and anecdotally found it very helpful. The thing I always worry about, this is like the analogy might be the benzodiazepines. We were using these for 30, 40 years before we had evidence they caused dementia and increased the risk of death. CBD may not have those effects, or it might, but it's so early in the research of that compound that I can't recommend it medically, just according to my standards. But I understand if you are desperate, you tried other treatments, you haven't gotten anywhere, you might be willing to take that risk. So it's promising, but I don't think we have enough evidence to really recommend it strongly yet.
I have one more. Excuse me. You talked about development of phobias from anxiety disorders.
Yes.
Have you heard much about therapy phobia, or not necessarily a phobia like you were saying snakes, but like a negation, a denial of the effects of therapy?
I've heard of people deny the effectiveness of therapy. Therapy phobia?
I've not heard of that.
I mean, there's a phenomenon of people not, I have to say, I did allude to that some people are afraid to go to therapy because of what it might activate for them. I don't think we've technically called it therapy phobia, but I certainly think you could look at it that way. But many of my patients are reluctant to engage because of the activation of anxiety that comes about discussing certain topics. Yeah. And for those folks, if they're not willing to do it, again, internet-based or self-help-based strategies might be the way to go.
Any other questions?
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, everybody. If folks could fill out the evaluations, we would really be grateful, and you can put them in the glass jar by the water. Thank you very much. Safe travels home. Remember 420 at Main Street Landing, Crazy Wise.